Thank you so much for joining us again this morning at Central Community. We were just discussing that it's been 15 or 16 months that we've been doing this live at 8:45 so we can broadcast it out around the world. Thank you to those of you who are kicking back at home with a cup of coffee, in bed, getting ready to worship with us. Thank you for those who are tuning in sometime during the week and are watching this. And for the very first time, thank you to each of you who have supported this across the months. What a blessing you've made the church as we've continued to grow, as we've continued to reach in our ministries, as we've continued to do our very best to be a blessing through all of this. Welcome to Central Community. May God bless you and worship today in the Word.
Good morning, church. Let's worship. If you'd like to stand in place or whatever you'd like to do, however you feel comfortable worshiping this morning with us. Who breaks the power? Sing it out.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in all his wonder? This King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. Into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice?
Join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity to gather together and worship. We thank you for the opportunity to share your word this morning. Holy Spirit, we would ask that your presence would be very near, that you might be senior pastor in this place, that you would open up your word to us today, God, that you would reveal the truth that you have for us. We thank you so much, Lord Jesus, for your presence in the world today. We think about the problems and the challenges and the struggles that families are facing. We think about the loneliness in individuals during this time. We think about the heartbreak of a pandemic that stretches out around our world, Father, where so many lives have been lost, not just in our country and the world, but right here in our own neighborhood. We would ask that you would come and that you would bring healing, Father, that you would restore hope. And Lord Jesus, we would ask during this time for those who feel alone, for those who feel like somehow they've been forgotten, we would ask that you would surround them with your grace, with your presence, that they might know that you're with them in this moment, just now. And for those who feel like they've fallen short, God, I would ask that your healing hand would be there to lift us up today. Heavenly Father, we come to you, and we would ask that you would use us today, that you would make us one as your church, Father, that you would lift us up. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Good morning, church. My name is Rusty. If you don't recognize me, I'm taking Bobby's place this morning. And I've got a song to share for you that I wrote, and I was thinking about how sometimes our humanness gets in the way of our humanity. Sometimes who we are, our humanness gets in the way of our godliness and what God wants to do. So this is kind of an introspective song about how we aren't done yet. We're working our way towards what God wants us to be. Have you ever lost your cool in a supermarket line? When the person in front of you has 30 items and you got 9, and you give the girl a look to melt the ice cream in her cart, and you don't think for a moment what that did inside her heart. Am I a stumbling block or a stepping stone? Do I break God's heart or make him proud that I'm his own? Am I a herder or a healer? Am I a prophet or a loss? Am I shaped by the chisel of the carpenter or a splinter on his cross? I'm only human, that's what we all say. When we're trying to make excuses for something wrong we did today. Did I make a mess of this, or was the mess made before me? As it was in the beginning, tasting sweet fruit from that tree. Am I a stumbling block or a stepping stone? Do I break God's heart or make him proud that I'm his own? Am I a herder or a healer? Am I a prophet or a loss? Am I shaped by the chisel of the carpenter or a splinter on his cross? Naturally imperfect, I was broken from the start. But his hands can make these jagged pieces more like a work of art than splinters on his cross. Sometimes a stumbling block, sometimes a stepping stone, sometimes I break God's heart, but he's still proud that I'm his own. Sometimes a herder and a healer, sometimes a prophet and a loss. But every day I'm more like a chip off the old block than a splinter on his cross. No, I'm not just a splinter on the old rugged cross.
Thank you so much, Rusty.
Thank you.
Absolutely a pleasure to listen to that kind of music that comes from the heart. What a blessing. 4 or 5 years ago, back when we were having winter, it was one of those days of winter. Here in Southern California, we get one day of winter about every 4 or 5 years. It was raining outside. Debbie was heading to go out to work, and she needed some help carrying some stuff to the car. And so I was hanging out at home. It was my day off, and I was in some shorts and a t-shirt, and I had my jacket out in the car, and I was still in my house slippers. And so I said, I'll carry that out for you, honey. So she went out ahead of me. I was going out, she opened the door, and suddenly I heard her laughing. It was raining, it was a downpour. My jacket was in the back of the car. I wanted to get to the back of the car before she left, get my jacket out so I could have it for the one day I needed my jacket. And I was wondering what she was laughing about. I looked out from the car, and I hadn't even noticed it, but I'd stepped out of my house slippers. They had run with the water down the rain into the gutter, and they were floating away like boats in the gutter. And Debbie chased down the street after the house slippers to try to save them because they were new. And as she chased down the street, she had an umbrella over her head, and then the wind caught her, just exactly like in a cartoon, and it blew the umbrella inside out. And she came running back with this umbrella inside out, yelling at me, what are you doing? What are you doing in the back of the car? I said, I'm getting my jacket, honey. I had no idea my slippers had even come off yet. There she's standing with my slippers in my hand. I turned to look backwards out the car. I'm in the back door of the car, and I started to fall out. And suddenly I'm thinking, oh great, I'm gonna fall and I'm gonna break another one of my shoulders with another stupid, and I only have two shoulders and I've broken both of them. I'm thinking, I'm gonna have another stupid story to tell about a broken shoulder. And then Debbie stepped forward to catch me. And I felt her hands on my back and I thought, oh great, we're both gonna break our hips. We're gonna be old people in the nursing home with two broken hips, each of us. It's raining, we're now soaked. We're laughing, and praise God, Debbie was able to hold me up in that moment. And I thought about how many of us have just tried to do something good, and in the midst of trying to do something good, we've fallen short. And so what we do is we avoid trying to do that good thing again. We avoid trying to stepping out. We avoid trying to just reach too far because we know what it's like to fall short. So when I'm talking about falling short when we long to stand tall, I'm talking about it from a very personal perspective, and I'm talking about it from the perspective that every single one of us can relate to. Because normally, when we fall short, it doesn't start with that great big drop off the Grand Canyon. It starts with just that step out the front door into a storm, and then losing a shoe, and then the shoe rolling away, and then someone trying to help us, and an umbrella coming undone, and someone trying to reach in while we're getting it. And it's one small event after the other until we find ourselves either A, in the arms of someone who was able to help us up, or B, falling completely flat and feeling like there's no way that we can ever stand tall again in our own lives. And so we've been coming from Hosea. You now, by now, hopefully if you've been listening along, this is the fifth week of it, you know the theme of the text is that Hosea is a prophet of God. He was called to marry an unfaithful woman. That unfaithful woman went out and became unfaithful even more, sold herself into prostitution. God said, I want you to go and I want you to buy her back out of prostitution, to forgive her and take her back and to be your wife. This is the message, he said, of my people Israel, who were unfaithful, who I purchased, and who then went back out into prostitution. Remember, there were a divided Israel at this time. There was Judah, there was Israel, there was Samaria in between, and yet all of them were worshiping the gods of Samaria that were caught up in between. This is some of the most ancient text in all of the scriptures. We've talked about the languages that it came from, the very oldest of all languages that are translated Even still today, some of you might be familiar with cuneiform. Cuneiform, if you were to go around the world today, I looked it up, in museums around the world, there are over 500,000 tablets of cuneiform. Cuneiform is more than 2,000 years older than the book of Hosea. It began in around 3200 BC in Samaria, which is southern Mesopotamia in current-day Iraq. Now, cuneiform, the word cuneiform means wedge-shaped symbols. It's all those little wedge-shaped symbols that you see marked into clay. And the reason they have so many tablets of cuneiform is because they were marked into clay. Papyrus that came out of Egypt, remember, it just fell apart so quickly. Even vellum that was hard to come by as a process, the long process of writing on it, prepared in killing cattle or killing sheep and making scrolls, it deteriorated. But cuneiform, as old as 5,000 years old, 500,000 existing tablets in the world even still today, and yet it wasn't even begun to be translated until around the 1830s. It went over 2,000 years without anyone in modern times knowing what it said. Then a French archaeologist began to translate some of it, and then a young man named George Smith. The British Museum of History, if you were to go there, even still today, they have over 130,000 tablets. A young man, 14 years old, who was consumed with the Assyrian and the Sumerian history of these great empires that were the very beginning of humanity, he began to study it, and George Smith then had access to this. The Biblical Archaeological Society, they acknowledged that this young man, just as a teenager without any college, had great acuity at this. And so they gave him access to all of these tablets, and then in his early 20s, he discovered what was then the Epic of Gilgamesh. Even still today, one of the oldest stories, and the deluge portion of that, that's the flood, which in every modern religion has some kind of story of the flood, and he was able to translate it and share it with all of them and bring it out. I tell you these stories to let you know that 2,000 years before Hosea, in fact, 2,000 years before Hebrew, ancient Hebrew, was even discovered as a written language or created as a written language, there were societies at work in the world. And so when Hosea came, he's bringing a message from God to all of the people, but specifically to the people of Israel, his people, and today specifically to us, because too many of us, our Bibles have become like the hundreds of thousands of tablets that sat in museums. They're indecipherable, but we don't read them. And even if we do read them, we don't put them into action. We don't take God's word and say, I want to figure out how to use this. And Hosea, one of the minor prophets, it's one of the 12, we really don't focus on him. And so that's why from the beginning, what I said is we're not going to be dealing in that which is controversial in Hosea, but that which is positive and proactive for our lives today. So in the 6th chapter, and just a couple of real simple verses for us this morning, and it'll be on your screen so you can read along silently as I read aloud. Remember, this is God speaking through the prophet Hosea, not as the very first words of humanity. Humanity had been continuing on for a long period of time, and not as words that are extant today, extant meaning that we still have these scrolls someplace or they're written in cuneiform. We don't. I mean, these words were passed on orally for generations. And for us now to have them, it's a great gift. Out of the 500,000 tablets that are in museums around the world, only a tiny fraction of them, even still today, have been published or have been translated. There just aren't people who are interested in the hundreds of thousands of stone tablets that exist to go through and translate all of them. And many of them are like literally a grocery list. Pick this up, pick this up, pick this. Some of the oldest writings we have are things like, this is what was in the trash. And so when we have something that's as treasured as Hosea, in these words, we need to pay attention and listen to it. So it says, O Israel and Judah, Remember, Israel, the nation, was divided in two states with Samaria in the middle. Oh, Israel and Judah, what should I do with you? Asked the Lord. Doesn't that just sound like a parent? What am I going to do with you guys? What's going on in your lives? Look at the way you're living. For your love vanishes like the morning mist and disappears like dew in the sunlight. I sent my prophets to cut you to pieces, to slaughter you with my words. That's pretty rough, isn't it? I hope that you never feel like when you come to Central Community or when you listen to the message that I'm just here to slaughter you with my words. But God was saying, God obviously knew this deluge story that moved throughout every major religion that we teach as Noah in the flood. I mean, this was God speaking to his people. He knew how to annihilate them with a flood. But he's saying, I sent prophets to annihilate you, to cut you with their words, with his words, as the prophets spoke to them, with judgments as inescapable as light. Isn't that beautiful? With judgments as inescapable as light. Now think about how we talk about, you know, all the light garbage in the world today and the light that takes over everything so that we can't pollution. It's light pollution. But this was an era when there was no light. This was at literally the midst of the Bronze Age, where light was never, but he says, as inescapable as light. Because nothing can run from light. Not even darkness can hide from light. Light shines brightly through all darkness. It says, with judgments as inescapable as light. And then where we really want to focus today, God speaking says, I want you to show love, not offer sacrifices. I want you to know me more than I want burnt offerings. I want you to show love, not offer sacrifices. I want you to know me more than I want burnt offerings. What's he said? That there was nothing that was important about the rituals of religion in that day? No, that's not what he was saying. He's saying there may have been some importance to all of those things that if you go back to Leviticus, if you go back to Deuteronomy, if you go back to any part of the Pentateuch or the Torah, you'll find that there was an importance to teach people the way to go in these ancient civilizations, just like today in our modern society. There is an importance to the liturgy. There is an importance to the gathering of the people together in the church. But he's saying, over and above that, I want you to show love. Over and above that, I want you to know me. This is so much more important than the ritual. This is so much more important than the burnt offerings. So I believe today that there are three profoundly important lessons that we can take from this as a call to action as God's church today, as God's people, as those who long to not just be lost and overwhelmed by all of those tablets of words that somehow we can't translate and can't put to work in our lives because we think we're just not smart enough. I mean, George Smith was 14 years old without any college degree when he began to go through the tablets, and he was the one who figured out how to translate this ancient language that had been a mystery for thousands of years and even still around the world is a mystery in so many museums. For you and me, we can be the ones who say, this mystery that's deep within us, that's allowed us to fall so short of what we know we were created to live up to, we can be the ones to begin to translate this today. This is our call to action. So it says we begin to stand tall, first of all, when we move through pain. When we move through pain, certain that God has spoken decisively. And so often for us, we have a tendency to come to pain in our lives and think, oh, well, God must not want me to go that direction because that just hurts too much. God must not want me to seek this out because that's just too much of a challenge or too much of a struggle. God's just put up a barrier. Have you ever thought that in your greatest pain, that's where God wants to move and provide for you? In your greatest time of difficulty, that's where God wants to speak to you. It says, I sent my prophets to cut you to pieces, to slaughter you with my words. Until we are humbled to the spot that we can realize that it's only God that can lift us up. He is the one who is speaking decisively to us. He is the one who is changing us. He is the one who can point us in the right direction, where we're right on the precipice of danger. When I was falling out of that car, I had no idea Debbie was about to catch me and to keep me on my feet. And for us, when we're falling and we feel like there's no way that we're going to be saved, God is ready to catch you if only you will call out to Him. If only you will turn to Him through this time of pain. We live in an era of pain. We pray for the end of this pandemic. Literally, not a week goes by that someone doesn't tell me that they don't know of a family, a friend, an entire group of people that have all gotten COVID-19 and the one that died. And it's become so commonplace that we've begun to desensitize ourselves to the death and the loss of young people who are slipping away. And for us to say, no, I want to go through this pain with people, certain that God has a plan and a purpose for me in all of this, certain that God will not let me down, but He's speaking decisively. I love the quote. It says, we're so quick to cut away pieces of ourselves to suit a particular relationship, a job, a circle of friends, incessantly editing who we are until we fit in. Have you been working hard to fit in? Have you ever thought that maybe what you're supposed to do is just accept that you have fallen? Scripture teaches, for all have fallen and fall, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And when we accept that, yeah, I know that I have fallen. And I know that without Jesus holding on to me and lifting me up, I'm completely lost. And for us to hear the decisive word of God through this time of pain in our lives, we can find healing and a call to action. Secondly, we begin to stand tall when we move with compassion. When we move with compassion as our living sacrifice each day. When we move with compassion as our living sacrifice each day. It says, I want you to show love, not offer sacrifices. Imagine that. Long before Christ Jesus spoke to us about loving one another, long before the Golden Rule, 800 years before Jesus began to teach us, here's Hosea speaking the word of God, I want you to show love, not offer sacrifices. Long before, Paul wrote to the church in Rome in the 12th chapter in the first verse, for this is your act of living sacrifice, to present your bodies before God. This is your act of living sacrifice. Hosea was writing, I want you to show love, not offer sacrifices. For you and me to live a life of genuine compassion in all we say and do. For you and me to say, what I long to do with my life is to live it out with real compassion. I am moved each week by the people who work in our food ministry. It's a new ministry around Central Community. We've always served the homeless here at Central Community with a food ministry, but now to open up to the entire community during this time of financial loss for so many, and a family loss, and we watch the cars line up for 2 hours this week, maybe 3 hours they were lined up. They started lining up at 6:30 or 7 in the morning until 10 o'clock they were lined up. And this last week we had a new opportunity for more food to come in. Marty and Josh and I talked about it just even before service. I've been thinking about it, and it's a group that will give us truckloads of food free so that we can distribute. But simple old us, we're already kind of at our limits. I mean, you know, there's one of those things where you think we're already going so many different directions, and this group is in Los Angeles, and we need to go all the way up to Los Angeles to the food market up there to be able to pick it up. And I thought all that requires is a couple more people in a team, couple more people to say, yeah, we'll be in charge of this on a weekly basis. All you have to do is call us and we'll be there. We'll take care of driving. We'll take care of picking it up. And it will feed the community. But what does that require of us to do that? Compassion. And that compassion has to be written into our calendar. See, compassion isn't that something that, look at that bum sitting on the corner. I think I'll give him $2. Compassion that's written into our calendar every day. Today, Lord, make me more compassionate. When God speaks through Hosea, I don't want all of these burnt offerings or sacrifices anymore. I want you to show love in everything you say and everything you do. I thought about what Abraham Lincoln said so long ago. He said, my concern is not whether God is on our side. My greatest concern is to be on God's side. For God is always right. For you and me, our concern needs to be not that, oh God, please be on my side over those other guys, but instead that we can be on God's side. Because God is eternal. God is the uncreated one. God is always right. And God is the one who, when we faltered so far, he was willing to send his only son to save us. And that's why that final point of call to action says we begin to stand tall when we move closer to Jesus. For each of us, we can never stand as tall as God created you to stand until you move closer to Jesus. Because Jesus is the one who stands every time that we're about to fall and puts his hands behind our back and holds us up. Jesus is the one who, when we're faltering inside with temptation, surrounds us with his grace and his presence. Jesus is the one who speaks to us when it feels like it cuts to the quick, like the word of the prophets that God said we're tearing them apart, and yet speaks to the truth of who we are. And then we open up to new life, new love, and a new change. And until we open up to that new life, to new love, and to change, we can't be the ones who impact everyone around us. We can't be the ones who are leading lives of compassion. We can't be the ones who are willing to say that, yes, I know this is a time of pain, but through this time of pain, I'm going to live according to God's promises and God's provisions. For us to say, I want to stand tall by moving closer to Jesus and opening my heart, it says, I want you to know me more than I want burnt offerings. 2,800 years ago, through the prophet Hosea, God was speaking to his people saying, all of these rituals that you're doing, as nice as they are to get your lives in order, what I really want is you to know me. And so that when Christ Jesus came to save us, it was that living presence of God in our world so that we had the opportunity to draw closer to God by knowing Jesus, his compassion, his example, his witness, his teaching. Are you always going to get it right? You're going to get it wrong as many times as your pastor, and maybe not nearly as many times as your pastor gets it wrong. I was walking through the food line this week, and the cars line up. Everyone else is setting food up everywhere. Pastor Ken's not here, so with Pastor Ken not here and him out on vacation, Marty and Josh and Mike and Stan and all the people, Ron and Patty, all the people standing up and just taking extra care to make sure that everything's right, all the food's in the right place. I'm walking down the cars, and we had this incredible donation from a group of food rescue. They rescue food that's getting ready to be cast out in one way or the other. 6 pallets of food that had come in. And I'm walking down the line telling people that, you know, we really didn't see where this food, normally we don't give away anything without it being touched by us, sorted by us, cleaned by us, everything by us. This had come and we didn't have time to touch it. It had gotten here Tuesday night. It had come in cases and pallets. It hadn't even been unwrapped, unstrapped, anything. We had cases and cases. And some of it was really obvious that it was good and perfect. There was an entire pallet of beautiful bananas I mean, thousands and thousands of bananas. That it was really easy just to give every single car a caseload of bananas. But we went through and we explained to people that what you're going to be receiving, we haven't seen yet, we haven't touched it. Do you want it or do you not want it? If you get it, there's going to be a lot of it, more than your family can use. You'll need to share it, you'll need to do it, or there may be something bad in there, you'll need to throw it away. And then we'd mark their car with just a piece of paper under the windshield. I was going through and a number of our people only speak Spanish. And my Spanish is muy malo. I mean, it's very bad. And so I was trying to speak my Spanish with people. I was trying to work my way through the line, trying to explain what it means for them to take an extra box. We don't know what's in the box. All these words that I really don't know in Spanish. It's a surprise. Suppreso? Whatever. I mean, I'm trying to do, there's a mystery. I didn't know what to tell them. Misterioso? I mean, I didn't know how to go about this. And then there was this one little woman that greets me each week the same way. She smiles and she looks at me. She's 5 or 10 years older than me. And she does this to me like this. And so I don't know what to say to her. So I always do the same thing back. So I went up to her. I assumed she speaks only Spanish. So I started struggling in Spanish to try to speak. She was real polite. She did a little bow to me. And then she looked, no, 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 she said. And so I thought, well, I'm using the wrong words. So I slowed down my Spanish even more. And I struggled to get box, a carta, there's this surprise box without, we don't know what's in it. I'm trying my very best to get everything together. And she says, no, 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 Lao. I speak only Lao. You know, Laotian, as in she's from Laos, the country of Laos, you know, bordered to the north by China, you know, between Vietnam and Thailand. I don't know if she came here after the Vietnam War, a refugee, if she came here after the Hmong people in Cambodia and escaped to Laos. I don't know how she came, but she speaks only Laos, doesn't speak English, doesn't speak Spanish, and here I am. I didn't know what to say to her. I don't even know how to say hi in Laos. I don't know how to say any in Lao. I don't know how to say anything in Lao. So I said, lo siento, I'm sorry in Spanish. I said, I'm sorry, and I just wandered away laughing to myself, and I thought about how many times we try. We give it our very best, and even still, we can't connect. Even still, we can't communicate. And even still, we fall on our face in the midst of it all. And in those moments, I didn't leave thinking that this woman thought I was laughing at her. She looked at me, and she put her hands together again, and she smiled, and she did this. So I, people around us must have thought we were stupid. Now we've done this 3 or 4 times, and I smiled, and I looked back, and I did that. I'm suspecting she's Buddhist. I mean, I don't know much about Laos. I don't know much about the religions of Laos. But I was just in such a disconnect that it must have been confusing for her, confusing for me. And I've been doing this for a year with her. Every Wednesday morning for a year, I've been greeting her in Spanish, been asking her questions in Spanish that she never answers. And I assume she's just a quiet person. But she didn't understand me at all. You may be living your Christian witness in a way, thinking, I don't know why these people aren't responding to me. I don't know why these people aren't listening to me. I don't know why they don't seem to be finding any kind of hope from what I'm saying. And maybe you're just not speaking their language. Maybe the language you're speaking is Biblicese, and you're trying your very best to only use King James when you talk to people. Maybe the language you're speaking is churchese, and you're trying your very best to sound just exactly like you'd think someone would sound at church. And maybe what you need to know is that what God wants is for you to know Him so that you can know others. What God wants is for you to show compassion. What God wants and has wanted for His entire long relationship with us is to know that He's not going to abandon you in His time, your time of pain, but He's going to speak decisively to you and give you direction so that you don't lose hope when you're falling and instead you can stand tall again. God calls us to action, each of us. Are we going to make mistakes? Absolutely. Are we going to fall down? Sometimes, you bet. Is God going to be there to speak to us with love, with compassion, and say, I've never forgotten you? Always. Always. Simple prayer at the bottom of your card this morning says, it says, help me to live daily in your light. I've tried too often to find my own way, and I continue to fall short. Forgive me. I believe you are God and my salvation. Give me courage to respond to your call to action. Thanks. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning. We realize that sometimes we haven't been the very best at sharing your love. Sometimes we've spoken so many languages that sound like they're from antiquity. And we've confused the people around us, God, instead of just showing compassion, instead of just loving people and knowing you. Right now, Lord Jesus, for that one who is listening, for that one who has fallen, for that one who's felt your hand hold them up when they've been so near to disaster, we thank you for being there, God, and for that one who right now is going through a time of pain. And they feel like they've been completely abandoned by you, God. I would ask that they might feel your direction through this time of pain, through this time of healing, that they can again reestablish hope, hope for today and hope for eternity, God. We thank you so much for words, words that are ancient, and yet words that are holy because you've kept them so that we might hold on to them today and find your truth for your church and for our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thank you so much for being a part of Central Community this morning. For those of you who are local and have been a part of our ministry to the homeless in downtown Los Angeles, Jackets for Jesus, thank you so much. We'll be going to the streets tonight. I think they're cooking barbecue chicken. I may not be completely right, but if you'd like to help out, you can be in the fellowship hall at 3 o'clock this afternoon. You can help them cook. You can help make peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. You can help them pack. You can be a part of the team. Come on out and join the team with Jackets for Jesus tonight. We'll be going to the streets by 7:30. We return here to the church about 12:30 in the morning. If you would like to show up about 11:45 tonight and help Jody and the team wash pots and pans and do all that, you are welcome to do that as well. There's always a place for you. Tuesday morning, our food pickup is at, I think, 9:30 or something like that. We'll have the packing team here by around 11 o'clock. If you would like to be a part of the packing team that gets all of our food ready to be distributed, you can be a part of that. You can be a blessing in all of that. If you'd like to help us pick up food, Pastor Ken's gone, come on out. Be a part of that as well. Wednesday morning, the food giveaway starts here at Central Community between 8 and 8:15. The line starts lining up around 6:30 of cars that wrap through the parking lot. You're welcome to come if you need food, most importantly. We have food. We want to share it with you. We want to make sure that your family does not go without during these challenging times. You can come out and get in line. You will be blessed, I promise. If you have food, come out and be a part of that wonderful blessing in sharing that in every single way. You can be a part of that. I'll be going to Siempre para los Niños, our orphanage, Wednesday afternoon. Please keep them in prayer. In Mexico, all of the schools are still closed, which means our children are now at beyond a year and a half without being able to have an adventure outside of the walls of Siempre para los Niños. I thought about how hard that has to be for them. Little Eileen, who's been with us since she was 3 years old, turned 10 last Wednesday. And there was no birthday party to go out, no school. They're back online at school. Debbie went out and my wife went out and just bought 3 more Chromebooks for them so they didn't have to fight over Chromebooks. So they could have them down there and they would all have enough for all the kids. Keep our orphanage, keep the church that's meeting right now. They don't have a pastor right now since Pastor Aldo left. Keep the church that we built down at Siempre para los Niños in your prayers as they gather right now. May God richly bless you and your home and your household during these challenging days.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger, our God is higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. Our God, our God, our God is healer, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power.